Hi everyone, I welcome you once again to another video for gate session. So this was the previous thing which where we have stopped the shape factors with themselves of two infinitely long black body concentric cylinders with a diameter ratio of 3 are dash for the inner and dash for the outer. So this is one of the gate question which was asked as a fill in the blanks. So before even getting on into this particular problem, we'll just know about little bit of the basics of the radiation so that you'll be able to counter this problem. So generally, when you try to take the heat transfer by radiation mode from a particular body, it was actually explained by Stefan Boltzmann law, which includes the intensity of all wavelengths emitted by that particular body at a particular temperature, and which is given by the actual area into Stefan Boltzmann constant and fourth power of Kelvin temperature. Hope you might have understood this already. And remember also that this has to be multiplied with emissivity, and emissivity is the one which actually defines that how much amount of actual heat has been converted into thermal radiation, and also this should be multiplied with something called as shape factor. So let us define what a shape factor and also emissivity. So emissivity is a term which indicates that it is nothing but a ratio of emissive power of a particular body at a particular temperature to the emissive power of the black body at the same temperature. Imagine that you have a body which is at a temperature T Kelvin, and it is capable of producing E amount of energy, right? Okay. How about a black body at the same temperature would have produced the energy? So this comparison or this ratio is nothing but your emissivity. So for a black body, you know that a black body is the one which is a perfect emitter and a perfect observer. And for a black body, I can say that the emissivity value will be equal to 1. And for all the other gray bodies, definitely your emissivity value will be less than 1, right? So this emissivity gives you an instant meaning that how far the heat from a particular body is being fruitfully converted into a thermal radiation, right? And similarly, there is one more factor which comes into play, which is called as shape factor. Okay, let us consider two bodies. Let this be one body and let this be another body, right? Okay. Now, let us assume that the first body is at a temperature of T1 Kelvin and the second body is at the temperature of T2 Kelvin. Imagine for our case that T1 is actually greater than T2. Now, this first body is now going to radiate certain amount of heat, and it is not necessary that all the heat which is being radiated by the first body should exactly fall on the second body. Only few of which will actually try to fall on the second body. So this is being determined by a particular factor which is called as your shape factor. This is also called as shape factor, view factor, or geometry factor. So everything is one and the same, right? So if I say that there are two parallel plates like this, and let this be the first plate and let this be the second plate, if I just use F12, it indicates that from the first plate, how much fraction of heat is actually falling on the second plate, right? Okay. Similarly, if I do so F21, it indicates that from the second plate, how much fraction of heat is actually falling on the first plate, right? So this is the exact notation and the meaning with respect to your shape factor, view factor, or geometry factor, right? Okay, now one more thing you have to understand, that let me tell you about the resistance, right? So you all know about the Ohm's law, which states that the potential difference in any circuit or wire is directly proportional to the current which is flowing through it, right? So if you have a wire and if you can maintain a potential difference, which is nothing but your voltage plus and minus, you can expect a flowing quantity which is called as current, right? And if you remove the proportionality symbol, you will introduce something which is called as resistance, right? This resistance will actually show you that how much is the loss, right? Similarly, so I can say that my electrical resistance is defined as potential difference by the flowing quantity which is current, right? So similarly, in case of our thermal resistance also, instead of voltage we can go for temperature difference, because you know that the two bodies under consideration should maintain a temperature difference so that you can expect a flowing quantity, and here the flowing quantity is nothing but your heat. So I can say that my thermal resistance will be defined as ratio of temperature difference to that of the flowing quantity, which is heat, right? So this has to be remembered. Now let us consider this first body and second body. Let this first plate be at the temperature of T1 Kelvin and second plate be at the temperature of T2 Kelvin, right? Now I can say that the first body or first plate, which is at the temperature of T1 Kelvin, is now capable of producing some thermal radiation, right? But it is not 100% confirmed that all the heat which has been possessed by the first plate is completely converted into thermal radiation. There will be some amount of loss, and which has been indicated by the resistance, and that is actually called as the surface resistance. Surface resistance. Okay. Similarly, I can also say that once when the thermal radiation has been formed, it now has to travel through the space, because we already assumed that throughout our discussion regarding radiation, we assume no medium is actually present, right? So within this space, this thermal radiation has to exactly follow a particular path or direction, right? And that is being indicated by something called as space resistance. It is not necessary that this has to travel exactly in this direction, it can travel in any direction, right? Which is being indicated using space resistance. So I can say one thing in confirmation, that space resistance is the one which is now going to include something called as the shape factor, because shape factor is the one which actually indicates how much amount of heat from a particular body exactly falls on the second body, and that is now going to be included in the space resistance, right? And surface resistance is the one which actually tries to indicate about something called as emissivity, because you know that the entire thermal effect cannot be completely converted into thermal radiation, right? Now imagine that once this thermal radiation, after reaching nearer to the second plate, now it once again should fall on the second plate and produce the heating effect. Now again this thermal radiation cannot be completely converted into the heating effect. There will be some amount of resistance associated, and that is again surface resistance. So I can say that when two thermal radiation, then two bodies are in radiative mode of heat transfer interaction between them, then there will be three resistance associated with it. One is your surface resistance, next one is your space resistance, and third one is again surface resistance, right? So when any two bodies are in interaction, these three resistance will come into play. And as far as we are trying to solve the numerical problems of the past gate question papers, so I'll stick on to the direct expressions of these. So your surface resistance is indicated by 1 minus emissivity by area into emissivity. Say for example, if you try to find out the surface resistance for the plate 1, it would be 1 minus emissivity 1 by A1 emissivity 1. Okay. Now let us check whether this expression is correct or not. And for a black body, we know that your emissivity is actually equal to 1. If you just try to substitute, your surface resistance will become 0. And that is why we call black body as an imaginary body, because it is capable of converting all the heat completely into thermal radiation, but that is not quite possible in the real case, right? Okay, so this is related to the surface resistance. And you also know that nearer to the second plate also, once when the thermal radiation reaches, it has to fall on the second plate and produce some heating effect, and that is also been reduced because of the surface effect. And this surface resistance at the plate 2 will be again rewritten like this, 1 minus emissivity 2 by A2 emissivity 2, where A2 is nothing but the area of the second plate, right? And emissivity 2 is nothing but actual emissivity possessed by the second plate. And in between these two, you have something called as space resistance, right? And this space resistance will include the factor of shape factor, and that has been given by 1 by A into shape factor 1 2. So if this F12 indicates that fraction of heat leaving from the first plate and falling on the second plate, right? So between, when two bodies are in radiative mode of heat interaction between themselves, then three resistance will be taken into account, right? So this has to be kept in mind. And also you can say one thing, when you consider two plates like this, I can say that the shape factor 1 2 will be actually equal to 1. Why? Because you know that this is flat, right? So now if you consider this as a second surface, now there are only two possibilities present here. Fraction of heat leaving from the first surface can either fall on the first surface or it can fall on the second surface, and sum of these probabilities is equal to 1. Then if this is the case, then I can say that F11 is now going to be 0 for this plate case. Why? Because it is exactly flat. So there is no chance for the heat which is leaving from the first plate to fall on the first plate itself, right? So I can say that the fraction of heat leaving from the first body and falling on the second body will be exactly equal to 1. And similarly, when a surface is concave, for this, suppose let us take this as the first surface, for this also I can say that definitely my F11 case here also is going to be 0, because anything which leaves from the first surface cannot fall back on the same surface itself. But if I try to take in the convex format, definitely there is a chance that fraction of heat leaving from the first surface can fall on the same surface. So for this case, I can say that my F11 cannot be equal to 0. So this has also to be kept in mind, right? And let us consider something called as reciprocal theorem, which is also very important. Reciprocal theorem. This reciprocal theorem can be obtained using the equilibrium condition. Let us assume that the first body and second body are in thermal equilibrium with each other. Then I can say that my Q12 will be equal to Q21. What is Q12? Heat leaving from the first plate and falling on the second plate. What is Q21? Heat leaving from the second plate, falling on the first plate. They has to be equal. That has to be equal. Then only I can say that temperature 1 of the first plate and temperature 2 of the second plate will be one and the same, right? So if you try to apply the same A1, sigma 1 and F12, T1 power 4 equal to A2, sigma 2, where sigma is nothing but your Stefan Boltzmann constant. And here in this case you'll put F21 because it indicates the fraction of heat leaving from the second surface and falling on the first surface into T2 power 4. Since they are in thermal equilibrium with each other, and if I assume that the area is also same, I can cancel the areas on both the sides, and I can cancel the Stefan Boltzmann constant on both the sides. And I can even cancel this temperatures on both the sides since they are in thermal equilibrium with each other. Suppose if their area is not equal, then this area term has to be considered. So which is nothing but A1 F12 is equal to A2 F21. So this is nothing but the reciprocal theorem. So if in the problem, if they mention or if they don't mention also, you can try to apply this for any thermal equilibrium case, that A1 F12 should be equal to A2 F21. And note down one thing here: fraction of heat leaving from the second surface and falling on the first surface, right? That has to be multiplied exactly with the area of the surface which is actually emitting. Similarly here, also you can note down that F12 being multiplied by area 1, right? Okay, now let us get into the problem which we are actually trying to see. The shape factors with themselves of two infinitely long black body concentric cylinders with a diameter ratio 3 are dash for the inner and dash for the outer. Okay, so this would have given some certain idea So now let's get into this. So this is what the statement which has been given. Let us draw a diagram first, and this is my first cylinder and this is my second cylinder. Concentric in the sense both have the same axis, both the cylinders have the same axis, and it is clear that your radius of the second cylinder is greater than radius of the first cylinder or the diameter case, and they have given that diameter ratio is 3. So I can say that larger diameter to smaller diameter ratio d2 by d1 should be equal to 3. Now always start from the inner surface first, and if I try to take the inner cylinder, I can say that the fraction of heat leaving from the first surface and falling on the first surface plus fraction of heat leaving from the first surface and falling on the second surface should be equal to 1, and this is nothing but the summation rule. This is the maximum probability, right? And now since the first cylinder is concave, as what I have said, this has to be 0. So anything which leaves the first surface cannot fall back on the same surface, right? And you know that between 1 and 2 you don't have any medium, and radiation mode of heat transfer is well assumed, and all the heat leaving from the first surface has to fall on the second surface, which has been indicated by F12 being equal to 1. So hope you might have understood this. Next thing is we can now apply the same summation rule for the second surface. So the fraction of heat leaving from the second surface and falling on the same surface plus fraction of heat leaving from the second surface and falling on the first surface probability should be equal to 1. Now I need to find out this, right? And you can't say that now F22 is equal to 0 because it is convex, right? Okay, now what I can do here is I can apply the reciprocal theorem which I said. So A1 F12 should be equal to A2 F21, right? And in that, F12 answer is already been known, which is equal to 1, right? So I can say that my F21 will be simply equal to A1 by A2. And surface area has to be used, and first surface area would be pi D1L. And if I assume that both the first cylinder and second cylinder are present to the same length L, this has to be assumed by yourself. No, you cannot expect this in the question. And you can cancel the pi and the L terms. So you are getting d1 by d2, but already you know d2 by d1 is 3, so d1 by d2 should be equal to 1 by 3. So this is what F21, right? So F21 is now known as 1 by 3, which can be substituted here, and this term can be brought here so that we'll be able to find out F22. So F21 plus F22 is equal to 1, and if you want F22, you can bring this F21 to the other side of the equation, and you have already found out this as 1 by 3, and hope so you'll be able to get the answer. Now get back to the question. Now what is the question that they have asked? So the shape factor with themselves, which means if you take first cylinder, the shape factor with themselves means it is F11. And if you take the second cylinder, which is the outer cylinder, with themselves means they are asking for F22. So F11 and F22 is what they are asking, and F11 answer is actually going to be dash for the inner and dash for the outer. And for the inner, F11 answer is actually 0, because you know that since it is concave, F11 is actually equal to 0. And for the outer, we have just now found out that F22 is actually found to be equal to 2 by 3, right? So this is how you try to solve this problem. It is a very important case problem where you can expect more number of questions to be asked both in ESE, GATE, as well as in TNPSC, AE, and any other competitive exams, right? So with this, I conclude this particular session. Hope you might have enjoyed this. Try to read this video one more time. And if you like this video, please do give your comments and try to share this video to the maximum persons you can. And we'll try to meet out in the next video, right? So for further online and offline crash course type of coaching and everything, you can contact us, and the numbers have been given in the description link. And those who are actually new to this particular video, please do try to watch my previous video on gate radiation so that you'll get an idea, because for each and every video we are not only discussing about the questions, we are also trying to discuss about the concepts related to the same questions then and there to give a better idea for the viewers. So thank you guys, we'll just meet up in the next class.